Fit and Wellness 2000. Fox aired the special, Who Wants to Marry a Multi-Millionaire? But during the filming, one of the contestants died suddenly backstage. What caused her sudden demise? Why is Fox so tight-lipped about the tragedy? Our story begins in December of 1999 at Berkeley Funeral Home. A gown used to dress a corpse for a funeral is removed from the body and returned to the store where it was purchased. A month later, Fox's planning team was in search of cheap wedding dresses for its contestants. They settle on a bridal shop in Middle America.
One month later, filming begins. Right in the middle of the show, one contestant becomes violently ill and drops dead backstage. The show goes on.
Later, Fox will deny that embalming fluid from the dress seeped into the contestant's pores. Doctor bites the teen engine and uses it to replace the engine in his Porsche. The doctor is killed in a crash, first time he takes the car out. Another doctor buys 15 transmission. He is later seriously injured in a car crash. A person buys two of the teen tires. His car crashes, and both tires mysteriously blow out at the same time.
We'll be right back. Speeding.
Roger.
Yeah.
Watch.
In this episode of Urban Legends, we delve into the sometimes twisted and disturbing origins of a few products, logos, and household items. We hope you enjoy it, but beware, it might change your perceptions of the little things in your world. Ladies and gentlemen, JK Cinema presents Urban Legends Series Origins.
Gillum Sykes Odell had a terrible time with his house, which was at one time reported to be the most haunted house in American history. His parents died a horrible death in their home when a local teenage boy murdered them. It turned out he'd once had a crush on Odell's mother, a former high school teacher. After killing Gillum's parents, the teenager killed himself. This happened just after Gillum graduated from Purdue University in northern Indiana. Shocked and distressed, the young man became a shut-in at his home.
It was like everything changed. The air in the house was different. Then, I started to hear the voices.
A frightened Gillum told a local newspaper reporter years later. Gillum tried to ignore the problem, and as a chemistry student, set up a laboratory in his basement. His parents' death left him not only with pain, but a fortune as well. Gillum never needed to work a day in his life. This left him lots of time to get acquainted with the ghosts who kept him company. Occasionally, he heard his mother's gentle humming from her rocking chair. At other times, he felt the comforting hand of his father on his shoulder. Then there were times when Gillum felt chilled to the bone. He feared for his life most of the time. Often, he would wake up in the middle of the night and find a kitchen knife balancing above his head on the headboard. He also found himself unable to breathe as though someone were choking him. Surely, this was the work of the teenager. Gillum had had enough. He contacted a scientist back at his university who he knew was interested in the paranormal. The man instructed him to study the ghosts and suggested that he come up with a concoction to keep the ghosts at bay. Believing that there was an element that could push lost souls towards the other side, he insisted that Gillum look towards his chemistry to find the answer. After burning his eyelashes off and working for weeks in solitude, Gillum came up from his basement with what we know today as paint thinner. However, he called it ghost tonic. He felt he'd found his miracle potion, because when he splashed it on the walls, the paint would fade and run, often in the shape of the phantoms he'd seen. Maybe just because of his delirium, or maybe from the fumes, it seemed to make sense to him. He insisted to those around him that the smell of the tonic when it made contact with the surface was the smell of dead ghost. Gillum ended up selling his concoction to another wealthy classmate who made his fortune selling paint and giving away a bottle of the ghost tonic, or paint thinner as it came to be called, with every purchase.
Thank you. London, England, 1888. A young child went missing. Her name was Carol Poles. Since her disappearance occurred a week before Christmas, many folks got involved with the search. Search parties went door to door in search of Carol, but this incident occurred in the same year as the infamous slayings by Jack the Ripper. Since the incident occurred in the same year as the unsolved Jack the Ripper murders, people were reluctant to open their doors, even for a search party. To indicate their non-violent intentions, the search party sang the songs of Christmas. The people in the neighborhood gladly opened their doors. It became such a bittersweet tradition, as each year after that, people went door to door and sang the songs of Christmas. The songs became known as carols after the missing girl. The tradition has continued to this day. Little Carol was never found, but that year, the Christmas Carol was born.
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse-open sleigh. Hey! Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse-open sleigh.
the paranormal, and the unexplained. In this episode of Urban Legends, we present five cases of unusual phenomena. At the end of this entry, we'll ask you, the audience, to vote on whether you believe the segments presented or not. Ladies and gentlemen, JK Cinema presents Urban Legends 6, Fact or Fiction. A strange and well-documented apparition phenomenon began in a small Spanish village called Belmez on August 23, 1971. On that day, Maria Gomez Pereira noticed a strange formation on her kitchen floor. The formation evolved each day until finally it became a face. Maria's husband Miguel took a pickaxe and destroyed the floor. It was then re-cemented and everything returned to normal. Until a week later. On September 8, 1971, the face that had been destroyed spontaneously reappeared on the kitchen floor. The Belmez City Council decided that they should excavate the earth beneath the kitchen floor to see if they can find the source of the unusual phenomena. What they found was shocking. There, buried 9 feet beneath the Pereira's kitchen, were headless skeletons and piles of human bones. The remains were removed, and the floor was again re-cemented. Soon later, the face returned, then many different faces started to appear on the floor. The faces of Belmez were determined to stay. Experts were called in to examine this phenomena. They took a slab of the kitchen floor back to their lab and found that the cement had no evidence of paints or dyes. They sealed off the kitchen and windows with wax, then covered the floor in a jacket and sealed the edges. The kitchen remained untouched for 3 months until it was reopened. They found the faces had evolved and moved about the floor. They also recorded audio from the kitchen and found ghostly chatter on the tape. Professor Hans Bender called the Belmez faces the most important paranormal phenomena this century. The faces continue to elude scientific explanation to this day. On November 16, 1996, professional cameraman Mark Liftel shot video of a parachuter jumping into a cave. He didn't notice anything during filming, but upon playback, he noticed a strange object swim through the air. Two years earlier, Jose Escamilla captured the very first rods on video. Rods have since been captured on video all around the world, and even in space. What are rods? They range from 4 inches to 100 feet long, and they travel very fast. Some speculate they are extraterrestrial beings. Some believe they are creatures from right here on Earth. Skeptics believe they are an effect of the camera lens or defects in the videotape or motion blurred objects. A woman working at a car impound lot in Oklahoma saw a ghost on the surveillance monitor. The ghostly figure appeared to circle around the cars. It was all caught on tape. The woman told another worker to go and check it out.
Actually, there wasn't nobody back there. The wind was still that night. Our alarm was on, so nobody jumped the fence back there.
Three vehicles on the lot that night were involved in fatal accidents. Could it be the mysterious figure was one of those spirits searching for its car? It is hard to say when El Chupacabra, which means goat sucker in Spanish, was first spotted, but it is known that this unearthly creature was first seen in Puerto Rico. People in rural areas claim to be awoken out of deep sleep by the pained screeches of their pets and livestock. Residents would find the bodies of their animals lifeless and drained of all bodily fluids. Only those unlucky people who went out during the night to inspect the sounds had any idea of what kind of beast was responsible for the horrific scene. Chupacabra was first reported in Puerto Rico, but reports have recently spread as far north as Massachusetts. This modern monster has also been seen in the American Southwest and parts of Asia, Central America, and New Zealand. It is suggested that the beast flies and swims its way to its next destination. There is no telling how many there are in the world, but reports have continued to grow in the past few years. All we can say is, keep your animals and small children indoors.
Tell us what you think. Since you're no longer watching this in an Adobe Flash format, the poll section for this entry has been replaced by a straw poll link. It'll be in the description. Cast your vote now.
Submitted for your consideration, JKCinema presents Urban Legends 7, Evidence. Orbs are globe-shaped lights of energy caught on film, usually during a haunting or other paranormal experience. Orbs are believed to represent the spirit of an individual that has died. They are made up of the life force that powered their body in life.
I took these pictures in the catacombs in Paris.
The catacombs are basically an extremely large underground grave for the bones of over 300,000 people. I took about 10 pictures there, and almost every picture I took, I found round spiral orbs.
On the back cover of the Red Hot Chili Peppers' Blood Sugar Sex Magic album, The band included a picture that contains an awl. The band claimed that the recording studio was very haunted and included the picture as evidence. Here is more evidence of orbs. What do you think? Urban Legends, series Ghosts, we presented ghostly evidence including ghostly video from all over the world, the theory that ghosts interact with televisions and computer monitors, an EVP, or electronic voice phenomena. Here is more evidence. This television is in the off position, yet an apparition appears inside the television. This photograph shows a ghostly mist in front of a house. The mist was not present during the time the picture was taken, and on closer inspection of the window, we see a ghostly apparition. A woman takes a picture of her sons on the 4th of July. There appears to be an unexpected visitor in the photograph. Members of the Air Force took a group photograph during World War I. When the photo was closely examined, an apparition was discovered peeking over the shoulder of one of the men in the top row. Everyone who knew the man recognized him from this photo immediately. He was killed 2 days earlier. EVP, or electronic voice phenomena, is ghostly audio, which is impossible to the human ear to detect, but through technology, we can communicate with ghosts.
Are you joined up by anyone, Nancy? On the other side? Are you with your parents or anything?
In Urban Legends, series UFOs, we presented photographs and video of aliens and alien spacecraft. Here is more evidence that we are not alone.
The attached file has what appears to be large sphere-shaped ships.
In Urban Legends 6, Fact or Fiction, we featured a segment on the modern-day monster, El Chupacabra. Most people who voted in the original poll do not believe in its existence. Maybe the following photograph of a chupacabra capture will change your mind. Death is the greatest unknown. What happens to us after we die? Humans have always pondered the existence of an afterlife. Do we live on after we die? Will we reunite with our friends and family in the afterlife? Humans have also always tried to communicate with the dead. We grieve the deaths of loved ones. It is difficult for us to accept that we will never speak to them or see them again for the rest of time. Religion claims to have the answers. Psychics claim to have the ability to communicate with the dead on demand. Both will offer their services for a price.
Reach out, touch faith.
And both warn us that they are only effective if we believe wholeheartedly in them and never question their logic or methods.
You don't like it? Kick my ass!
Sometimes their claims are downright ridiculous. Sometimes they're odd. Sometimes these claims yield no result at all. Harry Houdini and his wife Bess made a pact that they would try to make contact with each other once one of them died. They came up with a secret code that would act as proof of communication from the other side. Many psychics claimed to be in contact with Harry Houdini, but unfortunately, no one was ever able to recite the secret code back to Mrs. Houdini. In the 1920s, Thomas Edison speculated that one day science could perhaps develop a machine that would effectively communicate with the dead. 50 years later, such a machine was created. Catholic altar boy in Brazil often saw his priest, Roberto Landel de Moura, communicating with a small box. The priest would speak to the box, and it would speak back. Thomas Alva Edison, inventor of the electric light, the motion picture camera, and phonograph, was busily at work in his laboratory building a machine to achieve spirit communication with the dead. Brazilian researcher Oscar Darganel wrote the book Voices from Beyond by Telephone, which reported details of his long telephone dialogues with spirits. American photographer Attila von Salais began experimenting with a record cutter and had moderate success capturing spirit voices on phonographic records and a wire recorder. Marcello Bacci of Italy began experimenting in the paranormal. Soon he began recording voices using an old vacuum tube radio. A spirit team developed around his work, and they spoke to him through the radio sounds. People would visit him in his lab at home, and very often their departed loved ones would talk to them through Mr. Bocci's radio. Marcello Bacci still uses the vacuum tube radio, and his spirit friends not only talk to him, but sometimes they sing to him. The man who was to become a great pioneer in the recording of electronic voice phenomena, or EVP, Friedrich Jorgensen, captured voices on audio tape while taping bird songs. During the next 4 years, Jorgensen continued to tape hundreds of paranormal voices.
I noticed a very pleasant female voice in some of the taping sessions. It seemed to have an accent, a French accent. Is it Anne de Guigné? Is she with us?
Dr. Konstantin Raudiv decided to experiment with EVP. Soon he began developing his own experimental techniques. Like Dwergensen, Radev too heard the voices of spirits. Eventually, he cataloged tens of thousands of voices under strict laboratory conditions. In 1975, there was a significant breakthrough. Spiritual researchers George and Jeanette Meek met a psychically gifted man, William O'Neill, who could see and hear spirits. The Meeks provided funding and direction for a groundbreaking project with advanced spirit communication, and O'Neill provided the necessary psychic skills and electronics know-how. O'Neill recruited several of his spirit friends into the project. One of his invisible colleagues was the spirit of Dr. George Jeffries Mueller, a deceased university professor and NASA scientist. It became a rather astonishing collaboration between dimensions. Doc Mueller, in spirit, helping Bill O'Neill on Earth, design a new piece of electromagnetic equipment that would convert spirit voices into audible voices.
morning, this is George Meek.
This is Constantine Rosenberg. George, my friend, at last we succeeded in contacting you. Jeanette is beside me, and she wants to give you all her love. This is Constantine Rosenberg. This is the first contact you get from us. I suppose that you can hear me.
I can hear you very well, very plainly.
Fine, so this is the beginning of a new story, a new chapter, George.
Thank you, dear friend. Now, you may not be able to hear me, but I want to take this occasion to say...
And so, as we conclude this episode of Urban Legends, more questions are raised, none are answered. As we go about our busy lives living, is there another dimension where the dead is just as alive, a dimension from which spirits try to communicate with us through technology as we try to communicate with them? Has Thomas Edison's dream of a machine that communicates with the dead become a reality? Maybe. Maybe. Like any psychic or any religion, Spiricom is only real if you believe in it.
Here at the JKC Archive, hope you enjoyed this very special edition of the Urban Legends series. Check the description below to find a complete, comprehensive list of media used in this project, including the original credits of each entry. Just keep in mind that not everything was found or sourced. More info can be found within the link in regards to that. Hope your Halloween was great. See you next time here on the JKCinema Archive. I'm going to go eat a shit ton of sloppy joes now. Good night.